Tozer always cracks me up. He reminds me of, well, anyways, he's just challenging. Reminds me of my utmost for his highest, which is always a fun book to read, to be challenged by, to grow by, to develop a perspective that, you know, we need to have about the times that we live in and the reality of who we are in Jesus as opposed to what we think we are in God. Jesus has a way of driving a point home where when we talk about God, you know, a lot of people just kind of go, oh, yeah, and they get all kind of like distant. Yes, of course, God and godliness. And, you know, I'm so far removed from that. I'm like a microphone standing in front of you, and you're way back there, you know. And we're holy, and you're not. And we're all kind of like, you know, learning together, but we'll get there eventually. But Jesus, that's personal. He drives the point home because Jesus hits you where it counts. He talks directly to you. He's personal and personally involved. In Tozer, the high casualty figures, the high casualty rate among Christians. No comment. When his disciples heard it, they were exceedingly amazed, saying, "Who then can be saved?" Matthew 19:25. God hath called you to be Christ's. God hath called you to be Christ's side, wrote the saintly Rutherford. And the wind is now in Christ's face in this land, and seeing you are with him, you cannot expect the lee side or the sunny side of the bray. Boy, is that an old English word. Nowhere in the teachings of Christ do we find anything visionary or over-optimistic, ever. He told his hearers the whole truth and let them make up their minds. He didn't mince words. He might grieve over the retreating form of an inquirer who could not face up to the truth, but he never ran after him to try to win him with rosy promises. He didn't change the message. The reality was there. All this is to say that Christ is honest. We can trust him. He knows that we will never be popular among the sons of Adam, and he knows that his followers need not expect to be. If you are popular and you have thousands flocking to your message, you probably only have hundreds who actually hear it, and maybe 10 that will follow to do it. The wind that blows in his face will be felt by all who travel with him, and we are not intellectually honest when we try to hide the fact from them. Sin is sin. Separation is caused by the reality of sin in a person's life. By offering our hearers a sweetness and light gospel, and promising every taker a place in the sunny side of the storm, we not only cruelly deceive them, we guarantee also a high casualty rate among the converts on such terms. When you don't share the whole truth and nothing but the truth, then God doesn't help you, because the reality is when the person comes to a place of having accepted the gospel and they discover that they have to deny themselves, they don't. What kind of Christian is a Christian that is obsessed with himself, possesses himself, and chooses never to follow a God who says, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me? The reality is that if God hasn't caused a person to die physically, caught crucifying their own flesh, then how could they be born again of the Spirit to be raised from the dead if they're still living after the flesh and the lusts thereof? We tell them that if they will accept Christ, he will give them peace of mind, a wonderful life. He has a plan for their purpose. He has a purpose for their life. Solve their problems, protect their families, and keep them happy all day long. They believe us and come. And the first cold wind sends them shivering to some counselor to find out what went wrong. And this is the last we hear of any of them. Christian costs your life. There is no doubt. Anyone that tells you otherwise is a liar. The gospel cost Jesus Christ his life in order to bring it to you. God so loved you that he cost his son his life, and it cost God his love that he shed abroad for the world, because he had to turn his back on his son because his son became sin for us. and that probably broke his heart. There's a cost to being a Christian. There's a cost to the gospel. Anybody that tells you that you're just going to get saved and wants to prevent you from being in hell and give you heaven and pretend that this life is going to be a picnic table for you just to eat and choose and pick up all the positive things of life is a liar. And the truth isn't in them. Because you are going to go through trials. You are going to be challenged. You are going to be beat up. You are going to be stomped on. You are going to sin. You are going to fail. You're going to be miserable at times. And that's part of being a Christian. That's part of being reality for Jesus freak. Because I see always those who say all the right things and do all the right things and have all the joy of the Lord run right out. And when they fall down and smack their nose against the reality of life, they forgot what they were taught. And they go their own way. Some possibly lose their salvation if they ever had it in the first place because they were lied to. I have seen millions who have turned away from the Lord, and I've seen millions come. It's not about finding yourself or loving yourself. It's about denying yourself and following Jesus. Because if you have Jesus in you, He is living inside you, you'll know it. And whether you go to the left or the right, whether you sin or whether you are standing in righteousness and you're in the company of the believers and you're happy right now, God will bring a crashing reality of a trial or a tribulation into your life where you're going to face death. And the point is, have you developed a personal relationship with God to that point of knowing that you can be confident of your salvation on the day that judgment comes? I hope so. I hope nobody lied to you about what the gospel is. It is a personal relationship with God, but He is holy. And He does want you there, and He wants to make you holy. But it will cost you. And you need to weigh the cost. Because no man that hath given up house, his home, his wife, his children, his cars, his toys, his life, his location, his avocation, all these things that he claims to need and to want and to be in this world that he puts Jesus into, you may find yourself, Jesus doesn't want you in them, but he wants to pull you out of them so that you could be his servant, not your own. Which God are you serving? Is it the God of prosperity? The God of bless me? The sugar daddy in heaven? Or is it the living God who's alive and well and living inside me? And I pray he's living in you. Choose you this day whom you will serve, Moses said. And Joshua took them into the land. And they declared that they would follow the Lord. And they didn't. You have to choose, and you have to decide. Read what Jesus said on the Sermon on the Mount, and you tell me what it means. That's the cost of a disciple. That's the cost of being a Christian. That's the price you have to pay in order to follow Jesus.